Then I'd like to just add a few words about phosphorus recovery. Phosphorus recovery, phosphorus is a limited nutrient, a limited element that, and it's still abundant right now, but the U.S. is running fast, running out of phosphorus. And one of the problems is, it's not always advertised, but we produce probably about two-thirds of the world's surplus food is produced here and in Canada. So that means we import, we use a lot of phosphorus, and it's in the products that we export. So we have to import phosphorus, or soon we'll have to import phosphorus. But Asimov, already in the 1940s, he put it very well. He said, we may be able to substitute nuclear power for coal, plastics for wood, and these for meat, friendliness for isolation, but for phosphorus, there's neither substitute nor replacement. So if we run out of phosphorus, we're in trouble. And this is some idea. Now, there's a lot of controversy about it. And some people say, oh, we have enough fertilizer phosphate for the next 40, century or two. But on the other hand, that phosphorus that is available is of a lower quality. So it's going to cost a lot more to recover that phosphorus. In the meantime, of course, we are wasting a lot of that phosphorus going out in the streams. And so here is a demonstration by, I'm quoting here, this Cordell, and he showed, if we really get into business as usual, we're going to be up there. But what will have to happen in the future? And that relates a little bit to my quote that I had at the beginning, the optimist thinks it's best of all times, and the pessimist fears that that is the case. And we are at this point here now, and we need to get as much recycling as possible in order to make up, because if we run out of phosphorus, we'll do have to things like diet, changing diets, because to eat meat takes a tremendous amount of phosphorus to produce that meat. If we eat cereals, it's much less. And so it's food chain efficiency and agricultural efficiency. Apparently, many places, farmers can actually grow the crops for another 4 years. There's enough phosphorus in the soil. But if you're a farmer, you're never going to take a chance. You put the phosphate fertilizer in, even though it's not needed. So, but there needs to be a cooperation with the government to really study the need for adding more phosphorus. All of those things need to happen. But in the meantime, what we can do, although it's a very small portion, recycling some of that phosphorus. So when we do biological phosphorus removal, the phosphorus cannot go, it's either in the effluent or in the waste sludge. And if it's in the waste sludge and we get very high removal rates, down to, as I said, like 0.1 milligram per liter, it means about 99% of the phosphorus is in the waste sludge. When it's digested, that is released, and it would be returned to the plant, or else we have to do something else with it. So in this case here, this is an idea, what's called Bostrup, that was developed by Clean Water Services, and I said, okay, that's rich in phosphorus, so let's add some of that fermenter material in here, release that phosphorus. This is from the waste sludge, the surplus sludge that we produce. Release that phosphorus and then send it down to capture it. And it can be captured as struvite. Struvite is magnesium ammonium phosphate. After we digest, we have a lot of surplus ammonia that's normally returned to the plant. And we have phosphate, obviously, if we do phosphate removal. So, but by releasing it beforehand, we have less problems with struvite in here, and then we can have this reactor and recover the phosphorus. And here are a number of examples of struvite precipitation that's already in the works. This one is most successful, and mostly the reason there is that they produce a beautiful pearl. And because I've really been supportive of them, the Clean Water Services, when I was in Singapore, they made some of these crystals, struvite crystals, and I've got a pair of Cufflinks. It was still like pearl that was made from here. And what happens is that struvite is a really a very pure form. And so here you see what they do is they've got this upflow tank and they take the centrate in there. That's magnesium, ammonium, phosphate. The only element that's in short supply is magnesium. So they add some magnesium and they add caustic to raise the pH. And then they form these crystals. And as this is an upflow and you see the different diameters, they grow the crystals, the heavy crystals would be down here, and this is where they harvest them from. And that's what the crystals look like, and it's almost pure struvite. So there's no organic matter control in there, but it also recovers about 20% of the nitrogen is involved in there. So here we see some of the plants, and the most recent one is stickney, where I mentioned earlier, by simply switching off air, we managed to get more phosphorus removal. And they're recovering phosphorus now. I forgot what the numbers is, but it's huge. But you'll see in the tanks that here is one of those reactors at Rock Creek and at Clean Water Services. And these are the reactors for Chicago. They've got three of these very large reactors for producing the struvite. So that is going on. This is another one. It produces a struvite that is not, this is the PAX process, that is not such a desirable, shall I say. But the one thing about struvite is it doesn't dissolve. When you put it on your lawns, for instance, it stays there. It doesn't wash out every time you irrigate the lawn. And when the roots get to it, it starts dissolving it. So it's a slow-release fertilizer of great value. But this is a type of fertilizer that's produced in some of these other plants. And what they do is they just return it to a fertilizer plant.